Neela, we want this discussion to be about your journeys, how you came into Hindustani music, how you started learning, where did you go actually also to study, and then where did you go to listen to other people sing, where did you go to maybe teach music. So different kinds of journeys that you've undertaken over the last many years that you've been a musician. You can just start talking about all of that.
About hearing music, I remember that in my early college days, when we were living in Thana, we used to come to Kavashji Jahangir Hall to listen to great musicians. And it was quite far, but that's how I have heard Onkarnath Thakur in his old age, when he had four students sitting behind him with a tanpura, singing with him, and in between he would just stop, he would wipe his tears and he would say, "Mujhe yaad aa rahi hai, aur ek bandish main aapko sunata hoon." He would speak about the bandish and then, "Chalo bhai, shuru ho jao." Then he would start singing that bandish. All that, I felt, my God, can one do it in a concert, in a big hall like this? But since Onkarnath does it, fine, it looks quite okay. It's very personal. He treats this as a personal platform. And he talks to the audience. He shares his own experience and memories with the audience. That's his personality. Some people don't do it, some do it. Onkarnath ji did it. And so that was very interesting. Because I've never met him, but I feel as if, oh, I know the person. So, I don't know whether you can make a kind of a inference from about presentation that you should not talk about personal or you should talk about it. I think all this becomes a part of the memory, the social memory, the cultural memory. So, it's okay if you are made that way, you talk about it. Birju Maharaj ji used to talk also. And that was the beginning of my journey to understand great minds, great musicians, great artists.
Who else did you hear? Who were the other musicians that you heard? You said that Birju Maharaj also spoke about
himself. I heard...
But other famous musicians of the time that you went all the way into town to listen
to? No, I don't remember having heard any such great person at that time. But I had seen Birju Maharaj ji. And he was very young at that time, very slim. And his moments were so great at that time. And I feel as he matured, his expression, his bhav batana was becoming better and better. But his dance was superb at that time. And I can still visualize Birju Maharaj's figure in Kavashji Jahangir Hall. Later on, after about in late 60s, Brijnarayan, who was a very important organizer of music and dance in Bombay. He used to organize a concert called Kalke Kalakar, in which he presented all the youngsters. And then there was Haridas Sangeet Sammelan, in which all the elderly senior musicians and dancers were performing. In that Haridas and Kalke Kalakar, initially from 6 to 7, there was a lecture demonstration by a dancer. And that was very interesting. Sunil Kothari used to conduct it. He used to get them to talk and explain, and dancers used to come, musicians used to come. I also went once or twice there to know what how they explain dance movements and the footwork and the gestures. So that I found very interesting, that Brijnarayanji considered leg dance as an important aspect of a cultural festival.
Where was this held? Where was
this festival? Was in CJ Hall, Kavachi Jangir Hall. Then later on it was in Rang Bhavan and on Mahapalika Marg. There, Rang Bhavan was a great place for such festivals those days. So all that Brijnarayan did, and he really groomed the audiences in Bombay, I feel.
Both for music and dance, is it?
For music and dance both. Since 60s or so, I have seen that. And I don't remember, we have to refer to some books since when he began. But he must have begun much earlier, maybe early 50s or so. Immediately after independence, whatever cultural happenings were conducted, I think this must have been one of them.
What about more informal gatherings like in Trinity Club? Did you attend those when you were in college?
Trinity Club, I went there once only to hear somebody. Was it Sharad Sathe, my Guru Bandhu, or somebody else also? I don't remember very clearly. But I sang there myself, and that was very interesting. I like that small baithak and people who are very senior, very experienced listeners, and I sing the oldest form of Gwalior Gharana, and they were happily surprised that here is a young girl. I was much younger at that time, and young girl singing this old gaiki. Are va, tumi chhan manta. You know, I sang a Khayal Numa. They were very surprised that I know a Khayal Numa and I have the Taleem and I learned from Arolkar. They were very surprised that I learned from Arolkar Bua. Because Arolkar Bua was not a very popular figure, either as a performer or as a teacher. Because he explained things very well and that was not much like.
I see.
Strange it is.
So it's part of the musical culture that you simply have to experience it. You should
I
not talk about
so
it.
I think so. That was the idea. But then some of us, many poets and filmmakers and some literary people with literary background, they all went to him because they thought, huh, here is a person who explains also. And he had a great art of Gwalior Khayal to explain. So that was fantastic. But he was liked by Brijnarayan. Because Brijnarayan was there into leg dance and performances. So Brijnarayan always organized his concerts. Once a year, he used to tell Arolkar Bua, Chaliye, aaj aaiye, aap humare yahan ko gaana hai. Kab gaayenge, bataiye. Usually it used to be in January that Bua sang there.
So the explanation was given in Hindi or English or Marathi or?
In any of the three languages. Sometimes in Hindi, sometimes Marathi, a little bit English, everything.
How did you decide to go and study with Arolkar Bua? And how did you come to Gwalior Gaiki?
I was learning Jaipur Gaiki earlier from Ganpat Rao Tilak. And I learned for 3 years and I used to perform. I performed khayals in Jaipur Gaiki, and then I thought if I have to just sit and practice this fast dance and perform on the stage, it's rather very mechanical and I don't want to get into this area. Life is very vast, life is very interesting. Then there is the movement, left movement, which is waiting for me to do something. I would rather do that. And I gave up music. I did not sing, I did not learn. But I could not stop singing at home. My tantura was there and I used to tune it and sing at times. In fact, there is a very interesting incident in 1967. There was an earthquake in Koyna, and at that time the whole Bombay was shivering around 4 o'clock in the morning. And I thought, I saw my Tanpura shaky. I got up suddenly, I said, my God, I can hold myself, but my Tanpura, I have to hold it. So I was holding my Tanpura and I said, oh, some chores have come or something terrible is happening. What is it? It stopped. And a little later we came to know what it was. But this I remember, because this was again, I think, used in Arun's film. In Tivra Madhyam, Arun has used this incident. So I could never give up singing. But I stopped singing, learning Jaipur Gharana. And then I heard Arolkar. I could not understand him.
Where did you hear him?
I heard him in Mumbai Marathi Sahitya Sangha. In those days, concerts used to be held over there. And our great poet Manohar Oak and the theatre personality Damu Kenkre, who were great fans of Arolkar, they organized his concert. And Manohar Oak, of course, he said, Baiko, Aikles ka Arolkar la. Ka Aikles ma gaano? Maybe not, I haven't heard music properly, but I would like to hear him. Then he said, ye ma, Shanwari ye gaanala. So, then he said, Kipita ahet ka. Then he said, yes, kiti ghetes tu. Then me and my father and my brother, all of us went to hear Arolkar. That was the first experience of listening to Arolkar Goa. I could not understand anything. And he used to live in Shivaji Park, so I happened to meet him. And he won't recognize me, because I was one of the listeners. So I went and met him and did namaskar. Goa khub chhan vatla pan mala kahi kala nahi. Tar mi yeu ka tumchakade asat aikayla Sharad Sathe tumchakade shikto. Tar tyacha lesson la alo tar chalel ka. Goa said yes, come. Then he said he comes very late, he comes at 8:30. Chalel Goa mala kay harkat nahi, ratri 8:30 is not very late. So I used to go to listen to Sharad Sathe's lessons with Arolkar. And that was also very interesting. Sharad Sathe did not mind it either. And Arolkar Bua welcomed. Because then Arun and I, we both were totally impressed by his explanations. So we invited him home for lunch and he was talking about his aesthetics and Khayal Gaiki and how it was in 19th century, how it has come down to us and how one has to preserve this Gaiki. So I think my liking for Gwalior began with that. And I realized that this man has some different kind of aesthetics to talk about. It's not like aam taur pe jo bataya jata hai. There is a melody and there is a taal and you sing the ah, oo, ah, and then you sing fast dance and that's it, arrive at the song. That's enough. This was not like that. That appealed to me a great deal. Because I found the general scenario of music was very taan oriented. There was less bhav expressed, which I found in Omkarnath as well as Birju Maharaj. I then learned from Lachhu Maharaj, Birju Maharaj's uncle. So Maharaj was a great one in Bhav Batana. So I could not appreciate music without any experience, without any Bhav. And I found that in Gwalior. So I turned to Gwalior. And then the word was very important in Gwalior. Then I said, well, this is very interesting. If the word is important, then there will be a time when I can make my composition, my word will be there. each one can sing one's own word. It has to go on with times in history. If it stays stuck with 18th century and 19th century, it's like singing mythology. It's like singing Ramayana and Mahabharata, or it's like singing the old musical plays. So, but if I can sing my own experience, that's great. I must learn that Gayaki. That's how I turned to Arulkar Bua. And
what did he teach you first? What rag did you start with?
Yavan Kalyan. Avagunana kijiye gunisana. You know that bandish,
no? No, I don't think you taught
me. No, you haven't learnt it. Oh, that's a tough bandish in teen taal. And my taal was totally bad. And he used to play, and I made several mistakes. And then I said, Guamala Bharat nahi hai taal. Honestly, I was telling him, Guamala Ajibat nahi hai. Mala Paratas nahi kai karao. Then he said, with your left, you have to count. I said, ho ka bara. So I started counting with my left hand. And in between, I used to make mistakes. But I think it was his playing along with the singing that gave gradually a sense of taal, sense of rhythm in me.
He's playing what?
He used to play tabla.
Is it?
Yeah. He played tabla and he taught. And that was the way to teach in the old days. There was no tabla machine. I think many singers even now take the dagga baya in hand and they play the baya. I did it initially, but if you have students who need sarega regama corrected, then baya is not necessary. And then if you are surviving on music, you have to have all this sarega regama tuitions. That's also inculcating some kind of love for music in them. So I don't look down upon it. At the same time, I feel that one wants to teach the aesthetics, the beauty of this gayaki, and also one likes the students to come up with something new. And that also happens, I think. Gradually, my students were composing, and they were writing on music. So it happens by and by.
How many years did you study with Arulkar Bua?
I studied with him from 1969 till he was there. But initially for 8 years, I used to go to him every day. Every evening I was there with him and I used to learn. And he...